They're finally back.
Meet Remus and Romulus.
Or are they? There's been a lot happening in the last few days since the Dallas-based company named Colossal announced that they've revived, or as they called it, de-extincted the direwolf, which is the biggest wolf species known to this day and which died out approximately 13,000 years ago. But did they actually do that? How strong is their evidence? These are the topics we'll be debating in today's video. Let's talk about the science behind all of this. Apparently, Colossal is basing their claims of de-extinction mostly on the appearance. And here I also quote Beth Shapiro, which is an evolutionary biologist and is also directly involved in the project as a chief science officer. She said during this project that, and I quote, "Species concepts are human classification systems and everybody can disagree and everybody can be right." This is what she said in an interview to Michael Lepage from New Scientist. In another interview she had with ABC News, she said, and I quote, "I think that the best definition of a species is if it looks like that species, if it is acting like that species, if it's filling the role of that species, then you've done it." But is that enough? Is that entirely true? Well, as we all know, looks can be deceiving. And nature has its mind-boggling examples in this department. You see, in nature, there is something that's called cryptic species. That means species that are physically or morphologically almost indistinguishable, but at a genetic level, they are very different and they do not typically interbreed. Just to give you a quick example, we can take the butterfly genus Heliconius, where we have a few butterflies that look like each other, but are actually totally different. So looks won't cut it. But what about the genetics? Well, here we have a very good article from Science Alert, which talked to Jeremy Austin, which is a director of the Australian Center for Ancient DNA, who said that the company created a white gray wolf, genetically modified to look as what the company imagines a dire wolf would look like. He points out here that determining the appearance just from the fossil record for the dire wolf is very hard because canines, here including dogs, wolves, foxes, as fossils, they look pretty much alike. So determining the specific physical features or morphological features can be challenging. Now let's take the discussion down to a genetical level, now that we also talked about cryptic species. Well, you see, dire wolves became actually genetically distinct somewhere around 5.7 million years ago from the gray wolf. And there are not any clear evidence of intermixing the gene pools. Now, of course, the company Colossal studied the genome, which they extracted from a 13,000-year-old tooth and also from a 72,000-years-old skull. And they looked at the genome, but they used gray wolf germline cells, which means they used sperm cells and egg cells from actual gray wolves, where they inserted some modification through the CRISPR-Cas phase system. They made 20 modifications to the genome, precise modifications, 5 of them referring to the color, and this is out of a 2.5 billion pair basis. We'll take a quick crash course into genetics. Pair bases are nucleotides, which are some of the main components of the DNA. There are 4 types of them. We have adenine, cytosine, guanine, and thymine, and they usually intermix by the formula ATCG. Back to the story at hand now. Jeremy Austin stipulates that in order to make a direwolf or something that looks as much as a direwolf as possible, you need more than 20 modifications. You need anything from around a few tens of thousands to a few hundreds of thousands of modifications. And even that might not make a full genetical copy of the direwolf. So are these wolves actually direwolves? Well, this is something time will tell, because direwolves are typically described as being 20% bigger than classic gray wolves. And also the scientific community is lacking at this point many details from these non-peer-reviewed research. So what will happen to these dire wolves? Will they be released into nature? No. The company made it very clear that they are going to be kept for the rest of their lives at the undisclosed location where they are going to receive full care. They also mentioned that the wolves will not be allowed to interbreed with each other. And it's actually a good idea not to release them into the wild, because their habitats, which they evolved in and which they lived in, do not exist nowadays. So they might actually risk becoming an invasive species. disrupting the ecosystems where they would be released into. But why all the fuss? Why all the effort, the energy, and the financial resources in this project? What was the purpose of all of this? Well, believe it or not, there might actually be some long-term benefits from all of this research, because the company is aiming at protecting the other species that are on the brink of extinction. They started already working with the authorities to improve the gene pool in the red wolves populations in order to preserve them. They also have other goals, like for example, reviving the woolly mammoths and maybe other extinct megafauna species, but time will tell how that goes. But what about you? What do you think of all of this debate? Is it a good idea to revive extinct species? Is it an ethical thing to do so? Is it dangerous? I'd love to debate this in the comment section, so let me know your opinion. And if you're also a science enthusiast, you might consider watching this video over here.